So OpenIO is a company founded in 2015. We are an object storage vendor. We build our own open source project and much more around it. So we are now dedicated to high performance and scale for big data and AI use cases. So I'm Laurent Donnel, and I will briefly introduce my colleagues here. So I'm the CEO, I'm also a co-founder, and I'm a co-creator of the technology way back in time. Stacy, our CMO, has joined us in 2019. Damien, our developer advocate, joined us a few weeks ago now. And Kuhn, the same, he is a manager of a part of our R&D. So I don't know if you need more introduction about how we started OpenIO, but please raise your hand if you have any more questions about it. We are definitely building an innovative object storage solution, and we are doing this for quite some time now. Last time we met, a few of us, it was 4 years ago when we first introduced OpenIO for another Tech Live. And it was a delightful experience.
You've recovered.
Yeah, 4 years after that, yes. And yeah, probably we've made quite some path since then. So please raise your hands and ask any questions while we speak. Yeah, please.
It's a silly question. My understanding of object storage is around things like storing the metadata, storing something as a house, then looking up a library of houses and picking one that's nearest. So you store things in terms of what they are and get approximations back, rather than storing large objects. Is that not a thing? Am I missing a point totally?
So I don't know if you're missing the point totally. I will not express it that way. We tend to store immutable objects, immutable pictures, immutable videos, emails.
A picture of a person, though.
Yeah.
I can store the fact this is a person, they have a white skin, they're about 5'10" tall.
So this is all about metadata that you can add to an object, yes.
Metadata will actually return to me an object that's close enough to what I'm looking for.
If there's enough metadata, you can probably do that. The de facto standard API for object storage nowadays is AWS S3, and it's more a path-based request that you will make. Yeah, but you can definitely have a system, and we have done it in the past, where you can search for metadata, and it will come up with a name of objects that fits inside this metadata realm. So what we see is that since 4 years, the annual growth of the object storage market is not that great. It's rather slow, and it's only 22% per year. But something that these figures are from IDC, for the record. This is not something that you can compare with the amount of data the world produces each year. And the trend is to double every 18 months. So definitely there's a mismatch here while you compare the growth of the object storage solutions and the growth of the data worldwide.
Laurent, can I just point out that I always think those figures represent data that's created but not necessarily kept.
There's a
very big difference between the two.
I tend to think it's much more that's the data, that's the storage that's sold rather than the data that's created.
And don't forget, we never delete things really once it's actually created.
So they are created, and there would be some value to keep it. And so far, people tend to remove them, delete them, which is probably something that tend to have a loss in terms of value for companies.
So you only need to have one tag picture, and just a few variations on one tag picture.
But looking also at the concern of the IT managers, you see that capacity growth is their main problem. Then you see that the protection of data is the second of the problem. And then there is everything related to cost in terms of capital expenditure and in terms of performance. So our bet here is that the market has not found its perfect solution to fulfill its needs. So did object storage as a whole miss the target? Yes, somehow. They are all based on peer-to-peer algorithms. Most of them are built on top of peer-to-peer algorithms like Code from MIT. And this implies quite a few complexities. First, you need to rebalance each time you resize your cluster. If you add nodes, you have to rebalance data. Then, these algorithms tend to be rather slow compared to the hardware you have deployed. So you have a loss of performance there. And then, when you combine the two, the loss of performance and the complexity to scale, you end up with solutions that are a bit halfway.
You've also got the challenge that a lot of people still don't understand what object storage is good for.
So this
everybody
is my
in object storage thinks the world knows what it's good for.
And not yet. Yes, I know. And this is my last point here. Adoption, because of POSIX, has been rather slow. All the applications that were built before object storage were using POSIX, like file-based functions to access data. And it's not fading away that quickly. So object storage has not yet taken over, maybe because of that too. But this is changing right now. So this is my explanation of the different times that object storage has lived. First, archiving. During the year 2000s, archiving was the thing for object storage, and solutions were built for enterprise use cases from 100 to 1 petabyte, 100 terabytes to 1 petabyte maybe, and it was a write-only use case. Nobody would really care about reading those data anymore. Then, with the rise of the Web 2.0 use cases, emails, videos, pictures were to be stored somewhere, and object storage was kind of in its sweet spot. This is what I call the data sharing era. But still, people were using data at their own speed, I mean human speed. While you are watching a movie, you are looking at it at your speed, real time. But now, there's a shift. We are entering the era of data processing. And what is data processing? Is machine consuming data. Machines are now consuming data at their own speed. And it's unlimited speed. These are particularly seen for big data and AI.
You need to find a different term for it, though, because data processing's got a completely different context. It's been around since I was a kid. So you need to find different words. The idea's fine,
okay.
The words are wrong.
Okay, I will try to find a better word. But that's the time for the machine to consume data. And that's something that's very new. And the use case we are seeing in this space are more above 10 petabytes, reaching 100 petabytes sometimes. And it's very high perf, very high capacity, and POSIX cannot cope with it anymore. So something else has to be built, and high performance object storage is in its right spot there. And we are leading the pack. So I've put here, this is a blink of an eye for Enrico, because he put us in his analysis on the spectrum of object storage solutions directly in the high performance segment. And this is a new segment for object storage.
Yes.
So we say we are leading this new generation of object store. And these are our customers. And most of them are already benefiting of our high performance.
I had such a thing with tint-free presentation.
Maybe, Stacey, you want to follow up.
Okay, so Laurent explained who we are, what we do. OpenIO is actually quite different from other companies who build object storage solutions. And we can say that we're different because we have developed unique technology that other companies don't have. And so this is our conscious grid technology that's built on a node of grids architecture. It's very different from, for example, a ring architecture. It has nothing to do with it. And these unique differentiators are what allow us to have key benefits that really fit what the market is looking for today in big data and AI. And that is consistent high performance and instant scalability. And we'll explain to you in a few minutes how we are able to scale instantly without rebalancing data.
So we are built differently, and Conscious Grid is our internal technology. What we do here is, instead of using an algorithm to place data across the cluster, and this is a fixed algorithm, usually they use a fixed algorithm to do so, our competitors. Instead of doing that, what we do is we gather metrics from all the nodes of our cluster, and these metrics helps us to build a score representative of the state of the service inside the platform. The score can be from 100, which is the most available service on the system, to zero, service that is unavailable. So this kind of feedback loop in terms of availability of a service helps us to understand where to store a new data, a new object on the system. And this is a kind of a dynamic load balancing that helps us to really optimize the resource consumption in terms of hardware. This is very different from a fixed algorithm. And that helps us also to support heterogeneity among our nodes. So looking at it into more details, and this is a diagram that I wanted to build for you today, showing that an object is coming to our storage platform through an S3 connector, like everyone else. These S3 connectors, we call them gateways, are actually splitting the file into multiple chunks. And to understand where they should place it across the nodes, they ask to our metadata layer. And this metadata layer makes use of all the scores it has on every service of the platform to understand where it is best at this particular time to put the data. If you have any questions, you might raise your hand. These scores are evolutive, and the new service coming in will get also his own score. And this is how we say we instantly scale. Yeah, sorry.
How many metrics to establish your score?
How many metrics?
Yes.
Usually it's three. It's the capacity left on the device. Thank you for this question. This is very good. So it's the capacity left on the device so that we make sure that we tend to evenly fill our drives. But not only that, we have also the CPU and the IO bandwidth on the device. so that we don't send a new object to a device that is, that is already overloaded in terms of usage. At one particular time, we ensure that we always pick the most available nodes on the system and where it is the most efficient to store a new object.
Do you do anything on the checking the I/O metrics and the CPU? Because it might be that at the time you're rating the scoring, it might be a particular peak because there's a certain workload going on, whereas for most of the time it would have had a higher score, a higher
so
rating.
In fact, the scoring mechanism is very volatile, and scores can change from 5 seconds from 0 to 100. So we refresh the score every 5 seconds.
Okay.
So it's very, you know, when you add a new node, it gets ready within 5 seconds and start storing data. And it's the same for all the others. I mean, every 5 seconds, if there is a peak of load on one particular device because it's ingesting data, it will not be selected during this 5 second time slot.
But did you say that you've got a lot of bandwidth used to those exchanges just to take the scores?
No, it's very low. It's a minimal.
Take the metrics? It's very little?
Minimalistic. It's very. When we have done the terabit challenge with 350 nodes, mm-hmm. I think we measure the bandwidth of the what we call the conscious grid components below the 10 megabits per second. While we were doing more than a terabit per second of bandwidth for the application, so that's minimalistic. You know, it's very very tiny informations.
On the waiting to create the scores, you've got the capacity available, the I/O and the CPU.
Yeah.
And how are they weighted between them? So is the capacity more important than the CPU, or is the I/O the throttling factor? What's the weighting between the three?
So this one is an easy one. It's fully configurable. And it's based on a geometric mean. So that when one of the metrics goes to zero, when one metric goes to zero, the score is to zero. But then you just have a geometric mean, and sometimes you put capacity because you are most interested in having an evenly filled cluster. You put more emphasis on the capacity, but you can.
So the user can change the weighting.
Yeah, he can.
Okay. Yeah, the question was because historically you were using indirection tables.
Yeah, it's still
and
there.
How do you manage to have this dynamic data placements with this indirection?
So this is the metadata layer. This is where lies the indirection tables, and in fact, it's just to make it scalable. This is something I didn't mention, but each layer, each component of the system is fully scalable. So you can have as many data stores on your system, you can have as many metadata nodes and as many gateways you want. And how do we use the data placement and the directory of objects we have at this metadata level? It's we choose with the conscious grid where to store the data, but the metadata layer records it.
Okay.
So, because it's nice to have all this system, but if you don't, and this dynamic load balancing thing, it's very nice, but if you don't recall the next time you want to get the object where you have put it, you're screwed.
So yeah, no, but
you definitely
that's
have
why
to
I
record.
Can't.
Yeah, because you don't do it by computation. You are not finding back your data through computation, so you actually need a way to record where it has been stored. And this is the task assigned to this metadata layer.
Virtual map is in.
Yeah, you can think of it that way, yeah, for sure.
And the chunk size is the same all the time, so you split each object up into equally sized chunks?
So what we have with the chunks is of fixed size, of limited size. They are not of fixed size. That means that if an object is very small, it will end up as very small chunks. But if an object is very large, the chunks will be splitted in the object will be split in multiple chunks.
So do you do the same number of chunks for each object, or is that again variable depending on the size of the object? So the bigger the object, the more chunks you have?
Bigger the object, more chunks he has, yes. And especially in Erasure coding, where we have multiple meta chunks, what we call meta chunks. But this is going into many details, but we can discuss that later on if you want. This is, again, fully configurable. This limited size can be configured. Usually it's 100 megabytes, but you can just do whatever you want.
You said at the beginning that the object line was splitting in three. But so, it was an example? Or?
So this is a representation to make it more clear, because you'll see that we'll have more on top of that. So here it's three-time replication or 2+1 Erasure coding if you want to see it that way. But usually we are using a fully configurable Erasure coding that can range from 4+2. Usually we for small objects we are 4+2 or 6+3, and we can go to 30+4 if we want. For very large objects. Okay. So this is object one. You see that we have gone through one S3 endpoint, talked to one particular instance of the metadata layer, and then spread our chunks on multiple, what we call RoX, which is the chunk stores. For object two, it's exactly the same, but everything is different, right? We are crossing another gateway, asking information to another metadata store, and we are storing our chunks on several other services. And we do that because scores between the two objects have evolved, and it's best now to use these services instead of the previous ones. And if we mix the two, this goes, this at scale could blow your mind, because everyone's talking to everyone else, okay? Making micro decisions each time an object arrives, and choosing the best for this particular object, and 5 seconds later it will be another choice, etc. So this is how we place data, and this is how we work internally.
That is to say that it's impossible that two objects just came together at the same time to be placed somewhere.
Yeah, they can, because we have multiple endpoints, and one endpoint can sustain hundreds, I think nowadays, hundreds of connections, simultaneous connections. So you definitely can cross the same gateway if you have at the same time. And then everything else is available to answer. So everything can be parallelized somehow. Am I answering? Or?
Yes, it's parallelized, but it doesn't care of what happened on the parallel situation. You know what I mean?
Not really. Can you rephrase?
If you've got two parallel situations at the same time,
yeah,
and there is a score to be established,
yeah.
How to establish a good score if there are two things happen at the same time? You know what I mean?
So you mean you will pick
than that.
You will pick the same chunk stores, right? Is that correct? Is it your the problem you foresee is that at some point we will make the same choices if two
the
objects
same or different, but they have to care about how to care. Just they don't take all the situation picture of all the situation, yes. Because there is two situations at the same time. I don't know if you understand.
Yes, I think so. It's because of the time between two recalculation of the scores,
yeah.
Which is by default 5 seconds.
Yeah.
It can be tuned because it depends on the amount of on the topology of your platform.
Mm-hmm.
So most of the time you had more nodes to add more parallel processing.
Yeah.
But it's all about the amount of time between two recalculation of the score.
Mm-hmm.
And so in 5 seconds, how much data are you able to put at the same time?
Yeah.
But the thing is that by having that amount of time, we might have a few seconds. It's not real time, but it avoids to have a distributed lock for that case, because a distributed lock would not allow high performance at scale. So that's why there is that grain that you can tune depending on your platform, the specificity, the peaks. But by default, the idea is to say, during that amount of time, we expect that the score are frozen for a few milliseconds, seconds, whatever you decide.
And then it's a draw, because there are kind of randomness in you choosing your devices to write on, you know? So two objects will not probably not end up using the same chunk stores because of this randomness, you know? And the more...
So you're trying to split in, in different nodes.
And the bigger the platform, the more it happens easily, this randomness. Mm-hmm. Okay, with this? Adding a node to this is very simple, because you just register it into the brain, the conscious grid, and it's already prepared to accept new connections. There's no need to move data around before you can use this new node, okay?
If you've got a relatively limited set, though, and you're using probability, then if you're writing enough, then there will be overlaps when the two objects have tried to write a part of one of the blobs, one blob from each, to the same physical location.
I presume
you have some locking level at the metadata to stop that happening, because otherwise you'll end up with two different blobs, so with different data within them, being written to the same location that's then stored for two different objects. So when you recall them, one of the objects will be right, the other will be wrong.
No.
Probability says that has to happen.
Okay, probability, but we...
You're doing something else on top of probability.
Yeah, on top of that, we have different names for chunks. So, and they are identified with single UUIDs. So even if you write two chunks on the same chunk store at one particular time, they will be called with two different names, and what we will recall for one object.
So you get a fault for one of them, and then you'll rewrite it.
Sorry?
Meaning a conflicting write to a single point? Well, won't the write allocation system handle all of that? Well,
yeah, we just write two.
That's what I said. It's not just probability.
Yeah, and the consistency is handled on the metadata layer. So
that's what I asked.
Yeah, that's strictly consistent.
Can you go into your control plane behind this? What's the control plane mechanism that handles the metadata reads and writes and the load balancing and everything else that's required?
So this is all done by the code we have on the metadata layer, you know? When you want to insert an object into a container, you ask permission for that to the metadata layer that owns this container. And this is where you get reservation of the chunks.
Right. Mm-hmm. And but how does that run? Where does it run? Is it distributed across all of the servers?
Like, yeah, it's
there.
Definitely
is. Balance, and how do the objects choose which gateway to do requests?
So at the ingest level of the platform, we tend to use classical load balancing techniques, but we have also implemented a second level of load balancing, and each gateway knows the state of the others. So they can when one is overloaded, one can redirect to another gateway if necessary. We do this using return code 307, which is the code to do temporary redirects within a REST API.
My question is, in fact, in more a provision, because at long term you inflate quite hugely the metadata layer.
Yeah.
How do you manage to avoid that it becomes a bottleneck at a certain level?
So we have platform running for many years now. What happens is that when you had a new node, you also had a new metadata service. So as the platform grows, the metadata layers is growing too.
It's growing scalable.
Yeah, it's fully scalable. At the same time, you scale your data. So this is usually how the problem solves itself right away. And if you're not satisfied with that, we can always move metadata instances from one node to another one.
Okay.
We have all the tooling to do that now. This happens when you decommission a node. When you have one generation of hardware that is to be decommissioned, we just core every kind of service running on the node to zero, and then launch our movers, metadata and data movers, so that the node gets rid of all its information and puts it somewhere else on the cluster. Okay. And this is for Stacey to speak.
Okay. So this is somewhat of a different view on our instance scaling. So Laurent explained how it worked. And so this graph, we put this together to really show you that we don't rebalance. You know, we've had customers who have rebalanced data, and apparently it's a nightmare to do. You know, there are two choices. Either you do it fast and you risk your performance goes down, or you do it slowly. It could last several months, and you put your data at risk. There could be data loss. So it's really not a situation you want to get into. And so companies who do work with systems that rebalance data, they have to forecast in advance how much storage they think they're going to need 2 to 3 years out, and they have to purchase that storage for those 2 or 3 years in advance. And so OpenIO, we don't do that because we don't rebalance our data. So we can scale instantly, which means you can add new capacity when you need it, not 2 years, 3 years in advance.
Okay. So can everyone on the back hear me correctly? Yep. The goal of this demonstration is to show you what a real-life use case we could have around scaling and adding capacity on the fly on a real-life scenario. So as for today, what you see here is our dashboard. We have an OpenIO cluster made of three machines. Each machine host a bunch of services that we're going to check after the beginning, and provide our drive, so we have storage. So we have our OpenIO cluster that provide all the stack. So I'm the storage engineering manager, and the development team engineering manager come on my office today and say, okay, next week we're going to build a bunch of Docker images that will weigh a lot, and we need more capacity than what you already provide today. Okay, so I have a fourth node with some hard drive, a spare one, that I want to add now, so when my development team will start pushing the Docker images on their own Docker registry, all the data will be able to be stored on OpenIO without having to wait. So I don't delay the development team, I'm not slowing down their activity, and I'm adding storage right now. So let's launch the script that should take a few seconds, and obviously we are gonna study all the services. So as you can see, is it readable on the back?
Yep.
You can see using the colors, the three layers Laurent was mentioning earlier. First in blue, these are the storage layer. The data is stored here, and you can see on almost real time, it's updated all the 5 seconds, how are they filled. Then in purple, you can see the metadata layer. So this indirection, this directory that tells us where the data is stored on the blue elements. Finally, we have the orange gateways, so the S3 gateways, that has a load balancer in front of it. It's an HA proxy with high availability keep alive system. Finally, we have all other systems that are, let's say, the sidekicks, that host all our subservices, the movers, all the conscious grid system, the highly available system that helps us to rebalance between nodes, all the caching system, etc. On our use case...
Can I ask you a question?
Yes.
This slide. So, if you... I understand, you know, a little bit about the architecture. There is a thing now that you are exposing the S3 gateway, okay? Mm-hmm. What happens if I have a machine that is much more powerful than the others, including CPU and network? Can I spin up more S3 instances so to get more gateways from that that machine?
Yes, of course you can totally do this. It's only a scenario based on an inventory that references all the machines, and I can associate roles to each machine. Which means if I want a machine to appear to have, let's say, three instances of the gateway, I just have to reference the machine three times, and then it will just create three services with different name, and the load balancer will see three different endpoints on the same machine with different ports. So that port is totally configurable for each service. Does it answer your question?
Yep.
So while we were speaking, as you see, the view changed and it detected the new node, which is already available. So for the needs and the requirements of the demo, of course, I've put only datas. You don't have a metadata. And just to show that we can tune it, I've also added one gateway here, but you don't see the purple one because I wanted this to be fast, of course. So right now we can start browse our Docker registry, which has a few images. So let's add a new image. My development team in parallel starts to push images in that registry. So I already did the work for you. And we have Ubuntu image, which is in the Docker world, is a really heavy image. So let's put this image. It will start filling the different blue nodes based on the scoring, as we explained just before. So my machine consumptions, OpenIO is consumed by the registry. You see that Ubuntu appeared. So my development team can still work and start using that new capacity. And if we wait a few seconds, you will see that it starts to file this one. Up, let's move it. Yeah, it's all working on my machine, so we need a few seconds. So what we have seen there is that we can add node instantly, and the filling, which is not deterministic because it depends on the scoring, you see that immediately we have that famous score on each element, which is calculated and updated every 5 seconds. So of course, the score on that particular blob of data is lower, it's 84, because that one is already filled with some data. So that's how the system is behaving with instant scaling. So you can add heterogeneous hardware whenever you want, and the system will dynamically change every 5 seconds.
So, object.
Yes?
What is about the optimal performance in terms of chunking its data across multiple nodes?
So for that one, it's a mix of the scoring system decided by the metadata, but also the safety of the data related to the eraser coding. So the decision is a mix of both to understand where you put the object or read it.
But in your experience, what is typically in for high performance workload, how many nodes do you need to generate optimal performance?
Optimal performance? You just have to figure out what is the performance you want to achieve, and that will get you the number of nodes you actually need to reach that performance. We are scaling the capacity, but the performance at the same time. There is no limitation in the design that makes us less efficient when we have more nodes. So the more nodes, the more performance you get in a linear way. And this is something we're going to show just in a few slides. talking about the terabit challenge, because this is where you will see how we built up this performance.
By the way, my demo is terminated. Do you have any other question for this one?
Finished, not terminated.
Okay.
Just finished, not terminated.
No, terminated. It was a carefully chosen word.
You cannot
trust
terminate,
me.
You cannot terminate yourself. Is it working back again?
Maybe. Yeah, not.
Yeah, great. So, as you can imagine, big data requires high performance. The more you scale your data sets, the more performance you will require on the compute side. And this performance, it's performance reading data or writing data. So your object storage will have to sustain that performance. Machines consume a lot more data than humans and a lot more faster. So which kind of performance are we talking about? Here, I just wanted to show you that the kind of performance for big data is linked to the bandwidth. We are not talking of IOPS. We are not talking of block devices. We are talking of large objects that can be read and written at very high speed. And this is the bandwidth. So we are definitely looking after the terabit challenge to this kind of terabit use cases. And of course, the capacity is another kind of performance that has to be offered from the storage system. You cannot afford to limit your data sets in size. And so this is what we say. We are the real world's fastest object store. Our terabit challenge was not done on the test environment.
Sorry, why the asterisk?
This is just to...
Sorry?
Not in a test environment.
Not in a test environment.
Okay, so... Yeah, I can squeeze...
No, it's too far from you, yeah, for sure.
Yes, I need it. That's very sad.
So when we did this, we did it on a production system at Criteo Labs. If you know Criteo, these people are a French unicorn in the ad tech industry. They are running thousands of nodes, Hadoop clusters. They know what they are talking about, Hadoop. And they lended us 350 bare metal servers to run our test. So thanks to them. It would not have been possible to reach that kind of figure without this infrastructure to be lended to us. So I'm very proud of this result, and I want to show you a little bit how we did it. So I hope everyone is comfortable looking at this graph. So the red curve, this is the most important curve. It's the performance that we have achieved from the application standpoint, okay? Then you have the green and yellow one that are the technical boundaries that has been seen on the cluster during the test. And the scaled lines are the theoretical limits that can be achieved by the hardware we used. This is very simple calculation. It's the bandwidth each node had summed up to get the line. So as you can see, we have not started with 350 nodes. We started in the morning with only 50 nodes. And we started to put data on the cluster. After a while, we added 50 more nodes and in putting more data on the cluster at the same time, adding parallelization, more load in a parallel way. And we have done this multiple times during that morning to get the 350 nodes of the system. And achieving that number of nodes, we achieved the very high performance we reach with the 1.37 terabits per second. Two things can be said here. If we have had 50 more nodes, we will have had more performance in a linear way. And the other thing I wanted to mention is I think I've lost this one. Anyway, the more nodes, the more performance. That's the key. Yeah.
So is this bigger than your biggest customer?
So it's bigger in terms of nodes, not bigger in terms of deployed capacity. Because those nodes were very special nodes, not very optimized for OpenIO. It was compute nodes for the Hadoop system of Criteo. So there were, they had a few drives inside. I mean, few for us, 15 drives, 15 HDDs per node, which is rather low when you look at the size of the cluster. We tend to use 60 to 90 drive systems for this particular kind of capacity. But this is a 40 petabyte platform at the end of the day. So we have a customer that is running that amount of data with much less nodes at the end. Okay, and so it's good to have this figure, but it's also good to understand that our customers can just do a kind of, as this is linear, they know, they understand that they can get a fraction of this performance if they put a fraction, the same fraction of number of nodes in their data system. Yeah, Enrico.
So you kept adding nodes after, you know, every 2 hours, every hour. And but this means that the first bunch of nodes were already full at a certain point.
No.
Okay, so you had space left, because otherwise you could have achieved a better performance, because the load balancing is no longer.
So we made sure during this test that the amount of data coming in will not fill up the number of nodes we had at one particular time, so that the nodes would still be available later on in the
benchmark. Every time you add some more nodes, as soon as they fill up, you get some.
It was quick enough not to enter this kind of considerations. If we had, so what we do, when we have nodes that are nearly full, what we do is that we move some data away from them so that they are still available for new data coming in. But usually we have these problems on problems, not actual problems, but situations on clusters that are of multiple years, where the old nodes, if you want them to keep ingesting new data, you want them to get rid of some of the old data on the newer ones, so that every node has still some room for newer data and can bring you their performance. And what we are doing now is definitely to compete against HDFS on the big data storage. HDFS has been the traditional storage solution for Hadoop. It was co-located to Hadoop, running inside on the same servers, etc. Nowadays, people tend to feel like it's a limitation, because if you want to have new nodes, you will end up with new compute power, but also new storage capacity. And if you don't want the compute power associated to that capacity, that's a loss, because you are buying compute power for nothing. So a good thing is to think of this disaggregation as a way to optimize the storage cost of your Hadoop cluster. We do this through S3A, that has been developed mainly to allow the Hadoop use cases to run over S3, AWS S3, but as it is available, we take benefit of it. So this benchmark was run on a limited size platform of 3 nodes. OpenIO clustered sats at 3 nodes. So we had 3 Hadoop nodes running their own HDFS storage system versus a platform where you had these same 3 Hadoop nodes, but also a platform with OpenIO, 3 more nodes. So you might feel this is a bit of an unfair competition, but because there are more nodes on the right than there are on the left. Still, this is what you actually want, because you want to disaggregate your storage from your compute nodes. So we believe this is a fair comparison. And these are the preliminary figures of the bench report we will release. I don't know, Stacy, but in a few days, I think. So we have used TerraGen, TerraSort, and WordCount benchmarks. They are traditional benchmarks for Hadoop. And this is the figures we had. We are now on par with HDFS, and when it is about consuming data, we are a bit faster. So definitely a good alternative to HDFS for this kind of traditional Hadoop workloads. So there's nothing stopping you nowadays to run Hadoop storage-less with OpenIO as a storage backend. If you guys want the report in advance, you might talk to Stacy later on.
Welcome, for example, you get better results than for TerraGen or for TerraSort. So, what's the difference between all those benchmarks?
There are 2 benchmarks here, and 2 parts of each benchmark. Usually these benchmarks are run with data generation part. Like TerraGen is where it writes data to the system. Yeah. And then you consume your data, and this is what does TerraSort. The same happens for WordCount, where random text writer writes data to the drives, and then WordCount consumes the data.
Okay.
And this is where we appear to be more performant nowadays than HDFS. Consuming data. No, it's perfectly fine. Thank you for asking. Maybe Stacy, you want to do this one.
Yeah, sure. And so we just wanted to mention that we do already have some customers who are using OpenIO for big data and AI use cases. So we have a customer in France called Kairos, and they are a big data company. They analyze the energy market, so they pull down satellite images, and they analyze it, and they're adding, I don't remember the figures, but a ton of data every day. They're using OpenIO. And then the ICM is the Brain and Spine Institute of France. And they are also running AI calculations on OpenIO. And then we also just wanted to show that it's, so we've got customers and, you know, we know what we do, but there are also, you know, the outside world is starting to recognize that object storage can be used for high performance use cases. And OpenIO in particular has been featured several times in the past few months for these kind of use cases. So I just want to say it's not only us, you know, saying it, it's something that's starting to be recognized.
Yeah, we've got results from IDC. Do you have some Gartner Magic Quadrants or stuff like that already? Does that exist?
So we have been mentioned a few times in Gartner for an open source object storage solution, as an interesting open source object storage solution. Mm. But we have not yet entered the magic quadrant. Not for the moment. Working on it. Work in progress.
Yep.
Okay, time for the next demo.
So not only that demo is about the performance stability that I want to show you, it's also about the high availability and resilience of the system. So the scenario will be the following. Remember that four node cluster, we just added capacity, and our developers are currently reading and pushing Docker images that are stored inside this OpenIO cluster. And so that day, the second day, an incident will bring down the node number four, the brand new node. We have a CPU that is burned, so we have to change it. This will take a few minutes because we have nice sysadmin team. What happened in terms of quality of service, so in terms of performances and availability of our data? So let's start with first a nominal case. So I'm using a S3 client application, CyberDuck, and I consume and access the data inside that cluster using that application, so it's kind of visual. I've created a bucket of data named London, and we have our first development team that will start putting data here. So let's measure the performances in that optimal case. Let's call it team A. And now I'm copying a 400 megabyte file inside that folder. So we see we are around 30, 40 megabytes per second in copy. So now we have a first version and we have an idea of the bandwidth and the performance we can expect from the cluster right now. Sounds good? No question? Okay. So now let's play with the life of a production system, which means I completely remove the node number 4 from the cluster. Going back to our system, while the VM goes down, we'll check the metadata. As soon as the system peaks with its metric collection, it peaks that one machine is going down. We have something which is wrong on our cluster. And immediately, our system peaks that one node is down. Is it readable on the back still? Or do you want me to zoom in maybe?
That's fine.
That's fine? So as you can see, our system detects that something is wrong on the cluster. So I send my sysadmin team on the data center to put the machine up, repair it, whatever they have to do. And at the same time, I got a second development team that start working on the Docker registry and the S3 gateway and start adding data. So let's go. Let's copy more data, the same file, which is on another folder, so it won't reuse the same chunks. It's a full copy again. And as you can see, the performances are around 4 megabytes. So we still have the same amount of performances. Of course, I've 4 nodes on eraser coding 2 plus 1, so I always have 1 spare node, because this should be a nominal case. As you can see, the performances are still constant and the system is still available. So, okay, let's put the machine back inside the cluster. It should take a few seconds, and at the same time, we can still continue working and checking our data. We have still our Docker buckets. As you can see, all the blobs are stored there. We can still have the Docker registry, which is still available, and our developer keep continuing working. And at the same time, we are waiting for the system to go back on a fully operational mode at the highest performance with some margin. So we have still few alerts, and in a few seconds. Okay, we are back to nominal case. What does the view say is that, you see, the field level still have grown because we added data, and based on the dynamic system, we were able to do dynamic data placement with full eraser coding support, even with one or more nodes down. That scenario was a simple one. It was a 2 plus 1 because I have 4 nodes. Of course, on a real-life production system, you have eraser coding that are larger because you can provide more nodes to ensure the safety of the data. So yeah, that's all for that demo. We demonstrated that OpenIO is not only highly available and resilient, but also that the performance, as soon as you have the right scoring, the performance keeps exactly the same even when you have an issue on one machine, which means you can add, remove, repair machines during the life and you can still use the same quality of service. That's all for my demo. Any question?
So in a four nodes, how many nodes can you lose?
Sorry, I didn't hear the end of the
in
question.
A four node cluster?
Yes.
How many nodes can you lose?
In that case, I can lose two.
Because it's a 2+1 in Azure coding.
Yes. So in two, you can still read.
The data on node four.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah.
So therefore, if you lose nodes one and two.
That's a fair point. It's because I chose the architecture of no metadata node four for the need of the first demo. On real life, I will tend to split the gateway and metadata on one side and the raw data on the other side. So I would have three and three. So then I can achieve a really high level of high availability system and resiliency. But it depends on the kind of data load and the level of erasure coding that you want. You can achieve all topology, but that's right. So in that case, I can lose two nodes. I start to see an impact.
And one of them is node four.
Yeah, exactly. But everything runs here on that machine, so of course I cannot have a bunch of nodes. Okay, that's all for me. Does it answer your question? Thanks.
And the more nodes, the less problematic this is, of course.
What is a typical node spec today?
Node specs?
Yeah.
We tend to use three kind of configurations that takes into account the expected size of the platform. Meaning if you are building multiple petabyte systems, you will probably accept very easily to have a failure domain, which is one node lost. You will accept that it is somewhere around the petabyte. You can afford to lose one petabyte of data. So one petabyte of data is basically a 60 or 90 drive nodes. So for very large system, this is the kind of server we will advise to deploy. And then going lower in terms of starting capacity of the system, we will advise you to use 2U, 24, 26, 28, depending on the brand. And then if you are starting off with a hundreds of terabytes platform, we probably advise you to use 1U12 drives. That's the typical systems we advise.
Maybe you want to add that you can get the node back, because one petabyte is a lot, and you can, you know, check if the data that you have in the drives are still.
Yeah, you mean that if you are losing it, you expect to bring it back with nearly all the drives? Yes, for sure. Because rebuilding one petabyte of data will probably take time, since you have looked into us in more details, Enrico. We have worked on the parallelization of the rebuild. That's now fully distributed across the nodes. But it still takes time to rebuild one petabyte of data, for sure. So.
Drives can you lose in a node before the node itself is taken offline?
Nearly all. I mean, we don't see one node as one component of the system. We look at the services that are running on it. So if only one service among 90 is still available, we still use that service. But usually nodes are failing in a different way, you know. They are failing because someone pulls drives out and the backplane goes that way, and then the RAID controller loses the view on all the drives, and which is the kind of thing that happens. So either you lose one or two drives, or you lose the whole bunch of drives.
And are you raiding cross drives, or are you just having direct?
If you have 60 drives.
Sorry,
are you using RAID, or are you having direct attached
drives? No, we are not using RAID. Sometimes it's advisable to take benefits of the
architecture
RAID controller that has hardware caching mechanism to optimize a little bit the way the HDD works, but we can also do without. Yeah.
Laurent, so when you look at your design of your platform, the last half an hour has been about efficiency, performance, reliability.
Okay.
We're starting to see the higher performance use cases come out, and we're seeing companies like Vast Data, Stellus, even a vendor who was here earlier was talking about that sort of scenario. How are you going to move your platform into a competitive space with companies like that?
We have a slide for you, Chris.
Okay.
Just after that.
Yeah. In that case, I've and, set you up for
This will be Koen presenting it, but I think it will answer the question. We are definitely trying to be prepared when the new kind of hardware will be available.
And I was thinking more of things like protocols and other things that people are doing other than pure S3, because a lot of those vendors are talking NFS, they're talking about just trying to be unstructured, whether it's file or object in general.
So we have use cases, and we are signing a new customer these days that has asked a view in objects of what are the files he has on the system. And this is something we are willing to bring to our customer, and we have demonstrated him that we are able to do it. What I don't see in the future, but maybe I'm wrong, but today I don't see a full convergence between the two worlds. It will be quite cumbersome to have all these distributed logs mechanisms you have with scale-out file system exported to objects. So what will probably happen is that it will not be a full convergence of the systems, but you will get views on your files from the object. And at the same time, we are working with the GGU, Mainz University in Germany. These people are building a way to fill the inode tables when you ingest an object so that you get the file view of the object when it arrives. But still, that will probably be kept as views, meaning read-only. On the secondary way, it will be kept read-only.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So either you are read-write objects and you will see the file as read-only, or the other way around. But I don't feel like we can have a full convergence between the two kind of...
Does that mean you don't see your platform working as a scale-out file system?
We are definitely not a scale-out competitor, but we do scale our NFS volumes, so sometimes that is just what the customer wants. So, for example, Canal Plus in France is doing just that. I mean, multiplying the number of volumes on the system with multiple NAS gateways in front of the object store, and they work very well with this kind of setup. Yeah.
Okay.
That was the perfect introduction for our next topic. So we've you've seen a lot of information about what OpenIO can currently do with regards to performance and scalability, but we have quite an ambitious roadmap, and I'll talk a little bit about why we are doing that and how we think this is going to give value to our customers, and what kind of changes we're seeing on a hardware level, and how we think we can be ready for that. So high performance is definitely more than a big number. High performance is enabled by having a highly efficient architecture and implementation. And by having this highly efficient architecture and implementation, it's not just benefiting our largest customers, it's also benefiting smaller ones, and also benefiting customers that are not interested in the highest performance, but maybe more interested in cost. Because it allows you to kind of use lower, cheaper hardware to obtain the same kind of performance. We've seen in the last couple of years that the expectation around performance in storage has been changing a lot. NVMe is we are quite common now. Network bandwidths have been increasing a lot. 100 gigabits Ethernet is becoming fairly common. And this kind of bandwidth, it's not trivial to handle with commodity server hardware. So OpenIO is a solution built on commodity server hardware, and especially processing power and memory bandwidth available in these servers. You don't have an abundance of these things if you want to get to the bandwidth that NVMe and 100 gigabit Ethernet can provide. So we want to be ready for that. Another thing that we've noticed is that performance bottlenecks in practice are very hard to identify. And we want to help our customers in actually reaching the performance that we claim by giving them more insights in what is actually happening in the system when they're running their workloads, so that they can actually identify, okay, why am I getting this performance? What should I change in the system to get to a higher performance?
Is that also going to look at performance consistency?
Yeah, that's a good point. I think we can switch to the next slide, where this is actually...
I have a question.
Yeah, sure.
So you mentioned NVMe, but now that the NVMe standard is in, probably the next version will include the key value specification. Are you thinking about developing on top of that something?
So at the moment we haven't really made a decision on that. I can give you my personal opinion. I think what we're seeing with HDDs, with the SMR technology, and with flash devices, for example with QLC, is that this whole approach of having zones or bigger entities that you should actually write or modify in one shot, that's becoming quite common. I'm not necessarily convinced that this matches really well with a key value API on top of that. You've seen in the past, Seagate has made a key value store for the HDD. But essentially, if you want to use an HDD in the right way, you should do sequential I/O as much as possible. If you put an API on top of that that completely hides that aspect of the hardware, it becomes very difficult for the software, for what OpenIO is doing, to really use the maximum performance of the hardware.
So are you thinking then to adapt the SMR drives?
Because so that's
the sequentiality.
Yeah, that's definitely, I think...
it's an ongoing effort from our CTO Jean-Francois right now with his team.
Yeah. I think OpenIO is a good match for SMR hard drives. Okay. We're not just talking about higher performance, we're actually working on this. So we have people actually working on this project to get to a next level of performance and exploiting these much faster bandwidth in storage devices and on the network level. What are we doing? We're doing an end-to-end optimization of the full data path. In practice, what does this mean? We're making sure that from the moment the data arrives at the front of the system until it reaches the device, there are no copies of the data, so no memory bandwidth is being wasted. The implementation is not using locks so that it can scale across the cores of your machine in a linear way. And we're using low memory and CPU footprint. And a key point there is what you just mentioned, is about the fact that it should be consistent and deterministic. So we're using libraries and technologies, for example, that don't use garbage collection, so that we can actually know that what is going on in the system is what we have asked the system to do. And this is going to enable us to be really deterministic about performance. Some more technical details. You know that OpenIO is an open source solution at its core, and we're leveraging open source technologies. For this purpose, we're using C-Star IO, which is an extremely high-performant networking and library to write applications in. And that's open source and being used, for example, by SkylaDB, which is a much higher performance implementation of Cassandra. In addition to optimizing the data path, we're also spending a lot of time in increasing our instrumentation. That's two parts. One of it is metrics, more detailed metrics, so that you can know as a customer what is actually the state of the full system from a performance point of view, but also tracing capability. So for specific requests, you can ask the system, okay, where are you spending your time? So that for your workload, you'll be able to identify where are the bottlenecks and when, what should I change.
Are you going to try and get any generic customer-based metrics so that you can help people model what a good solution would be, depending if they've got a reasonably common workload that others have done before, so that they don't have to work it all out from scratch using services? Some sort of modeling capability to help design the platform in the first place?
That's probably going to depend a bit on what asks we get in practice. So I think the plan here is to do this first for a couple of specific customers, and learn from that.
Like the nuclear body in France, for instance.
So this is really going to enable our customers to get the performance that they want. We'll be offering this actually in two ways. So of course we'll be integrating this into our gateways, S3, File, and Swift. But we're also offering it as an SDK that customers can integrate. And mainly from the HPC scene, there's some interest in doing it in that way, so that you can really get the last bit of performance out of the solution. I've said a lot about performance. Of course, we're not only working on performance. We also know that to make our customers successful, OpenIO needs to be integrated into their technology stack, and what's on the roadmap there is an ask from a specific customer to provide Kerberos integration for the authentication and the authorization of the full data plans. Any questions about this?
Chris, does it answer your questions about what is next around performance? Okay.
Good.
Thanks. We expect, I'll be a bit bold on this, but we expect 3, 4, 5 times more performance out of the same hardware using this new data path on a single object transit. In the past, we have reached performance by maximizing the parallelization of our system and doing many, many things at the same time, and this is how we achieve the terabit challenge. Now we are focusing on large objects transit inside the system, and we are definitely optimizing it through this new data backend, if I, or your streams, it is called. So what's about trends? We have 10 minutes left. I will stand up. So we are seeing a very good trend in data repatriation. Many people that have started in the cloud, the public cloud, are now willing to get back to their own premises. It's mainly cost reasons driving this change. You can explain that with the cost. So these two customers are examples that have went back from the cloud, public cloud, to OpenIO in the last 2 years ago, and they are happy with that. In fact, what is arming with the public cloud is the business model of the public cloud. The more you use your data, the more you have to pay. So it was kind of interesting when you were only archiving your data, writing to the cloud, and then kind of never reading it. But when you have machines reading your data at very high speed, this gets unsustainable at all. So these people like Keros wanted to run more processing on their data, and they had no choice but to get out of this kind of nightmare. So another benefit of the private cloud is, of course, the privacy on the data And sometimes in Europe, it's interesting to make sure that you are not under the Cloud Act thing.
So just a word about the cloud native. Outside the trend and the buzzword, cloud native is all about having and using API for every primitive of your data center, not only the services, but also all the infrastructure bits and everything which sits in the middle. Cloud native now is built on toolings around containers, so I won't explain what Docker or Kubernetes are. They are the first of a long story of tooling. These toolings are running in a stateless world. When you have a Docker container, it's not expected to have persistent data. It's for mainly compute or processing. Mm. However, at least it has been built to be not persistent. However, they provide primitives for presenting file systems to the container so they can have access to this system. The main thing is that in that world where the container are a commodity for your infrastructure and system to automate it, all the persistence layer are built on the assumption of file system block storage, which means that the container system abstract away your system. So if you want to use object storage like OpenIO, it means that you delegate to the system, like Kubernetes, the changing of the models, which has an impact on the performances. In terms of developers, what cloud native means, it doesn't change anything. If you want to take usage of object storage, you don't have to change your application because your application natively discusses with the storage system through API, which is the really mean of the cloud native using API. So OpenIO, we are on the high performance discussing directly with the application. However, the cloud native has set the ground for new kind of patterns, because by automating everything, the trade-off changed compared to what it was a decade ago. So it doesn't create new things, it enables things that were already existing, but at what cost one decade ago? And one of these examples is what we call the serverless, which is in fact function as a service. It means from a developer standpoint, you have a piece of code and you want the compute system of your data center to only execute the function, and you have to pay only for that consumption when you need it, which means reading data, processing this data with a function of code on a machine wherever you don't want to care about server provisioning, and when it's terminated, the data is written back to the object storage and terminated, so you don't pay that. So it's a scale up, but also the scale down, so you pay only consumption. And in that world, we started early with a former feature of OpenIO, which was named Grid for Apps. So we gained some maturity and knowledge in that area before that the market was really ready about that, which means that we have an event system since the beginning of the OpenIO, which provide events for each piece of data written or read, which allow to have a ground for doing function as a service, because these events are what you need. This is the events that trigger the function execution, which means that in the near future, we will be able to integrate on existing system from the Amazon Lambda to OpenFAS, which is the open source system booked by VMware, from using Knative inside Kubernetes, where as soon as you have a Kubernetes cluster, you can do function as a service. We really think that OpenIO is going to be really easy to use in that context by providing the storage for these functions.
Depends that you want to go to Edge.
Sorry?
You want to work also on Edge, not only on the cloud.
So it's not a, no, we Edge computing today, we can run OpenIO on very minimalistic systems, but we are not yet seeing any kind of bought by our customers, I mean, use cases with edge computing stuff, you know. It's something we have been delighted to explore in the past with the ARM CPUs and the kind of stuff, but we are now focused on high performance, and I don't want to mess with this kind of stuff anymore yet. I want just to highlight that we are releasing a prototype of a Kubernetes CSI driver. It's you probably don't want to use it for very large scale production systems, but yet you will have the feature and the possibility on your OpenIO deployments. Coming soon, and I will be very fast. So what we have understood, yeah, I know I have 2 minutes left. Okay. So these 2 minutes left will be for these new things we are bringing up. So first, we have understood that people trying to repatriate their data from the cloud to their premises don't necessarily want to manage themselves their clusters. It's outside of their core business, and so they are asking us to do it for them. We'll take an operational commitment on their systems, and we will make sure that the systems, and we will manage it for them. We will make sure the system runs smoothly, and we will do it for them. This is an offer we call UHost We Manage, and this will be only offered to our main major customers above 5 petabytes of data to start with. Another thing, we have a partnership ongoing with OVH Cloud, the largest European cloud provider, for starting a new market segment with their bare metal servers, our software, to provide hosted private cloud storage. So you will have your own data on your own servers managed by us inside the OVH Cloud data centers. It's kind of an intermediate between going fully on-prem or going to the public cloud. We feel like it's a rare opportunity for our customers to get rid of the hosting part, but still having their hands on their data. And yes, some Kubernetes. That's what I mentioned about the Kubernetes CSI driver. And we'll try to end the Knative function as a service stuff. Yeah.
Quick question on this, very, very quickly. So yeah. Do you think, because, you know, you always work it with single services inside the single physical machine, so potentially you can have deployed all these services as containers. Does it make any sense to think about a OpenIO cluster inside a Kubernetes cluster? So for, you know, cloud deployment, these kind of things.
This one could be this could be a possibility where we leverage Kubernetes primitives to help us managing all the complexity of a platform like OpenIO, sure. Like high availability system, ensuring that for distributed lock, we always have 3 or 5 nodes available at the same time. All these primitives provided by Kubernetes could be a great improvement. We have to study that. This is something we have in mind. But right now, let's say the frequency of changes in something like Kubernetes is far more than what we expect in terms of packages changes and what our customers are ready to provide to us. There is still a gap. So maybe by exploring that, we could go on different areas with customers that are ready for that. But right now, there is still some slowdown for people running Kubernetes when it's about storing databases or storing persistent data. I don't say it's not built for that. I say the people and customers are still a bit afraid of that. But that could be an interesting
direction. It's changing too quickly. I mean, API and they have a lot of change.
Let's say now, after almost 6 years of Kubernetes, and I don't even speak of Docker, we have reached some kind of stability, especially on the API. So now is the right moment to start studying something like storage system and trying to leverage Kubernetes primitive for that. 1 or 2 years ago, it would have been a bit early because given the amount of things they broke on their API. So that's why there is we had to wait for stability before really using it.
I think maybe to add to that, in that context, you also have to look at what the customer is trying to do. Typically, Kubernetes is used if you want to have like a platform to schedule flexible workloads on. you want to combine multiple services. If you have a customer that simply has a need for a couple of tens of petabytes of storage, he might not want to schedule anything else on these servers than the storage services. I'm not sure if there is a big ask at the moment storage on top of.
They start to have. The thing is, Kubernetes is the same thing as OpenStack. Now we are at the level of the day two of operation, because day zero is discovering, wow, it's magic, it can do a lot of things. Day one is the installation, initial deployment, and putting it in production. And day two is the day where you have your first CVE or the first major upgrade of the cluster, especially on the network part. And right now, if you don't host your Kubernetes cluster on a cloud where someone manages it for you, or if you have a company like, I don't know, Giant Swarm or Rancher that helps you manage that part, day two can be really hard to manage. So that's why also customers are still slowing down, because technically you could split the nodes per roles in Kubernetes, because it's an orchestrator by nature, that where a machine takes this decision instead of a human, which should be more efficient. However, you need to be able to manage that infrastructure or container layer. So we start to see people having that on-premise, but it's still a young market. When you see the number of actors that come and go, still we have not reached the full stability on that market.